Scholastic Audio presents Making Friends with Billy Wong by Augusta Scattergood. Read for you by Kate Simses and Todd Haberkorn.
This one's for Evie, Lucy, Grant, Chase, and Jay. With love. Chapter 1. All it took to send my summer on the road to ruin was a fancy note and a 3-cent stamp. The minute that envelope showed up, Mama was packing my suitcase. Except for when I asked her for a pimento cheese sandwich at the SO gas station, I didn't talk the entire way from Texas to Arkansas. When you aren't speaking to the person next to you, 5 hours and 32 minutes is a long, hot car ride. But my mama talked. A lot.
Your grandmother wants to get to know you, Azalea. She needs your help.
She turned off the highway at the sign, Paris Junction, Arkansas, 3 miles, and she kept talking.
That's why she wrote that sweet note. You'll be fine.
I slumped down and clomped my cowboy boots against the front seat. After a while, I whispered, "You know, I'm not good with new people. Why can't you help her?"
"You realize I'd stay if I could."
"I realize no such thing." I crossed my arms and blinked hard to keep from crying.
"My new job's just started and your daddy's on the road."
Mama fiddled with one gold loop earring, then with the radio dial, and didn't say her real reasons. Number 1. I'm not allowed to sit at home by myself while she works till I'm 12, which I will be next year. Number 2. She's hardly come back to Arkansas since her own daddy died. Number 3. Every time she and my grandmother talk on the telephone, my daddy says fireworks start flying. What if I miss the Tyler Elementary back-to-school picnic?
It wouldn't be the end of the world,
Mama said. Well, it might be the end of my world. Okay, I truly don't care about meeting a bunch of sixth-grade strangers, even if my one true friend, Barbara Jean, swears the picnic will be fun. But I'm not admitting that. I'd better not miss riding up front in Daddy's big rig to the Grand Canyon. He promised I could go if I made straight A's in 5th grade. She ignored that and said,
"You might find a friend in Paris Junction."
"I have a friend. She's back in Texas." I glanced out the window when we pulled up to number 14 Ruby Street, a little blue house with a mailbox out front. Don't even know what to call my own grandmother. All I have is that one birthday card she sent last April.
"Try Grandma Clark. That's what I called mine."
Mama smoothed down her hair and checked her lipstick in the mirror before she stepped into the hot sunshine. She was finished with talking, finished with me. I gave up and stomped up the sidewalk to my grandmother's front porch. After, I slammed the car door hard enough for Daddy to hear clear to Texas. Chapter 2. Dragging my suitcase up the sidewalk inch by inch, I smiled a little at the gray-haired lady in a wheelchair. She didn't smile back. No, sir. Not one bit. But Mama was smiling big enough for all of us.
"Look at you, sitting up so nice,"
my old mama called out in a high, silly voice I didn't recognize. She straightened my grandmother's blue sweater, even though the sun was beating down hot as all get out.
"Sorry you hurt yourself in the garden. Here's Azalea, though. She's excited to help."
Excited my foot. But Mama nudged me, and I edged closer to my grandmother. She held her arm up to a green fern.
"Haven't seen you since you were this tall, Azalea."
The way she pronounced my name made me worry she was about to make fun of Daddy naming me after a bloomin' bush. Which he did when he saw the pink blossoms from the hospital room window the day I was born. "Hello, Grandma Clark," I answered, making sure I didn't kick over a flower pot with my new cowboy boots. Mama grabbed my fingers and my grandmother's and smushed us all together. When the butterfly ring I'd given her dug into my hand, I pulled away, leaving Mama holding on to just my grandmother. After listening to how dry this summer turned out, we finally stepped into a front hall that smelled like mothballs and furniture polish, and I squeezed my arms in tight, praying I didn't bump into the whatnot cabinet full of china cats. My grandmother blotted her rouged cheeks with a lace handkerchief and looked right at me.
"Appreciate you being here, but don't expect coddling. Never coddled your mother? Don't plan to start with you, which I'm sure Johnny Morgan, that daddy of yours, does."
Mama glanced out the front window, like she was worried our old car might crank itself up, drive away, and leave her here with Grandma Clark bossing her instead of me. "Sorry you hurt your foot," I mumbled. She took a breath that lifted her shoulders slowly up and down, straightening the flowered apron covering her lap. She said,
"My garden's getting away from me, especially my roses. That's all. Can't do much cooking either. Don't like to depend on neighbors. Your mother says you cook?"
If I didn't, we'd eat a lot of cereal and peanut butter. But I wasn't admitting that to a grandmother I hardly knew. Instead, I answered, "Yes, ma'am, I do."
"Right now, the kitchen's full of casseroles. Not up to my standards, but the neighbors mean well. Let's find something to eat."
Mama answered real quick, "Wish I could, but I can't take tomorrow off from my new job." I stuffed my hands in my pockets and frowned. "You're not staying for supper?" She reached out to smooth back a strand of straight hair hanging over my cheek. I pulled away.
"Promised your daddy I wouldn't be on the road all night."
Grandma Clark picked up her walking stick and pointed it at my suitcase like it might be escorting a family of dust bunnies into her house.
"Then show Azalea your old room, Jobell. Take the child's valise with you."
Following Mama up the stairs, I slowed down by a wall of photographs. Was I kin to these frowning old people? All I knew about my family was that Mama and Daddy had taken off from Paris Junction the minute their high school principal passed around the diplomas. I touched a crooked frame and stared some more. But Mama was already to the top of the narrow steps. I followed her and shoved my suitcase, my valise, into the little bedroom. I opened the closet door, then the drawers in the chest by the bed one by one. "If you leave me here, I might discover some deep, dark secret. Something you don't want me to know."
"Doubt that,"
Mama laughed and straightened a picture of a dopey girl herding sheep in a fancy pink dress.
"Let's get some fresh air in here."
She opened the window next to the bed, then fussed around with my petal pushers and blouses, fluffing them up and hanging them in the empty closet. But unless I'm back for the sixth grade picnic, I'm never wearing my new petal pushers. I grabbed the blue dress she'd forced me to bring. "I can unpack myself."
"Sure you can. And I need to start for home. Your grandmother doesn't need me."
"You're leaving me in a place full of people I don't know, in a house with a grandma who's practically a stranger? I need you," I said. "I did not need to be dropped off in a town where everybody gossips about your business. At least that's why Mama said she left Paris Junction." She reached out to hug me.
"I'll call tomorrow after 5 when the rates go down. Daddy and me, we'll be back to get you as soon as your grandmother's better. Pinky swear."
She wiggled her finger at me, but I ignored her pinky and turned around before Mama could so much as try to hug me again. And she was gone. Pulling back the window shade, just a crack, in what was suddenly my room, I almost chewed a hole in my bottom lip, biting back tears. It was hard to look at our old station wagon driving off, leaving me here. Mama couldn't wait to get back to Texas. Me neither. Instead of chasing Mama down the steps, I looked closer at what was now my room. On a shelf, three china cups and saucers and the most beautiful painted plate I'd ever seen were lined up in a neat row. I spit on the edge of my blouse and cleaned the dust off the big plate, dreaming up every excuse to hide out in this room. I opened my sketchbook with Azalea Ann Morgan's handwriting practice and "Keep out, private, this means you," written across the top. Even though I did win the school prize for Palmer penmanship, that handwriting practice was a trick so nobody'd discover my pictures. On a clean page, I wrote, "Leaving Arkansas," in perfect block letters, and doodled a bluebird flying over the Grand Canyon. I tried to copy the purple from the fairy's wings floating around the side of the plate, but there aren't enough colored pencils in the world to match that color. I signed the drawing with a flourishy line to mark the date I came to Paris Junction. Azalea Ann Morgan, August 3rd, 1952. Before I finished that flourish, banging started on the banister. Wiping any sign of tears off my face and dust off my fingers, I jumped up so quick something fell. The plate! Shattered! Could I fix it? Should I show my grandmother? Maybe, if she finds out I break things and really and truly I don't know a thing about prize-winning roses, she'll send me home. Chapter 3. My grandmother stopped knocking her cane against the stair post long enough to ask, "What took you so long?" I couldn't confess I'd smashed her beautiful plate into a million pieces. "Unpacking," I said quietly. She looked at me like I'd landed from outer space instead of riding all the way from Texas to help out. She shook her head at my boots, frowned at my knees banged up from falling out of a tree last week. "Let's get going before it gets too dark to see the tomatoes," she said, turning in her wheelchair. I followed her to the kitchen. "Hand me the bread off the counter," she ordered.
"Bread?"
"Stale, for the birds. Keeps them off my blackberries." I grabbed the bread, and before I could say, "Get me out of here quick," my grandmother had wheeled herself toward the back steps. Somebody'd hammered thick wooden handrails so she could get outside without falling, as long as somebody like me was holding her up. She clutched that rail, and I clutched her shoulder, and we struggled down the 5 steps. Way out back, as far as I could see, everything shot up tall. "Wow, your garden's really something, Grandma Clark," I said, trying her name out loud. What I thought was, who's going to be taking care of all this? She sank into a lawn chair and said,
"No rain this past week. You'll get the sprinklers out tomorrow."
Guess that answered my question.
"See that? Pigweed'll take over if you let it. Doc Wiggins told me if I so much as pull up a wayward blade of grass before this heals."
She shook the cane at the white tape winding from her ankle to her toes.
"He'll skin me alive and hang me for crowbait in my own backyard."
Biggest garden I ever saw. Grandma Clark pointed at a row of what looked like roses.
"Most important thing to remember? My prize winners are here, closest to the house. You do know the difference between a weed and a flower, don't you?"
Even though the truth was not exactly, I answered, "Yes, ma'am. Last week, Daddy and me painted 2 old tractor tires white and planted mums behind our duplex. You should try it. Real pretty." Grandma Clark sighed, shook her head, and nodded toward the back steps.
"Gloves in my gardening box. Watch out for spider webs. Bring the bucket for the beans and tomatoes near the side fence."
Scrambling under the wooden steps, I held my breath and hoped to high heaven there wasn't a yellow jacket nest up under there. I grabbed the gloves and bucket before a gigantic spider bit off my finger. I crawled out quick and went searching for beans by the fence. Instead of beans, I spied something else. A little white house. Was it a garden shed? A playhouse? Back home, my friend Barbara Jean had a shed full of broken pots and dried-up fertilizer behind her house. Grandma Clark's had two windows covered over with thick vines that were starting to creep up the blue door like nobody had opened it in a while. I put down the bucket and started up the twisted path to my grandmother's chair. "What's in that shed?" I asked. "Maybe a bike or some skates left over?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.